Hello everybody, and welcome to part one of what I hope will be a long series for complete beginners learning the game of backgammon. If I could just make a quick statement on what I'm going to try and do here. I'm going to do this, there's no script, I'm not writing it, not going to a plan, and I just sort of a chatty, informal way of discussing it, so if I start rambling and going on, or digressing, or off the point, you'll just have to forgive me for that. First thing first, I'd just like to say a couple of things about why I'm doing this. Okay, I've seen plenty of other videos online helping people to learn backgammon from the beginning, or sometimes for more experienced players. Some of them are bad, some of them are pretty good. But one thing I've noticed, particularly in the comments boxes of these things, is that they say things like, that's all very well, but it's not very good for beginners, or that's about as clear as mud, or this is a classic case of somebody who knows what they're talking about, but doesn't know how to get it across. And having looked at some of these, I think some of them, and the problem that they have is, they try to convey too much information too quickly. I'm not saying that they don't know what they're talking about, some of them are very good players, or I'm very good at teaching it, but just a little bit too fast for absolute beginners. So, in this first part, I'm just going to discuss some of the things that make up a backgammon set. So if you get your own, you'll know that you've got the right pieces. And a quick overview of why I think that total beginners find backgammon more confusing than perhaps it needs to be. Alright. So, first of all, we have the board, of course. You're not going to get far without your board. And the brief thing about the board is, I think when people see backgammon played for the first time, particularly if they're watching it on a tournament coverage on a television, or watching some people who know what they're doing play, confusion can arise because they look at the board like this, and sometimes they're looking at it end on, depending on where the camera is, which provides even more confusion. And they see certain pieces of this colour this side, and certain pieces of the same colour this side across the board. And they naturally make the assumption, as in games like chess and checkers and draughts, that one player sits one side, one player sits the other, and this is their side, and this is the opponent's side. And they wonder, well, why are some of this player's pieces over here? And when they make a move and they think, why are they bringing pieces from their side back to their side? And you're thinking, this is very confusing. The thing to grasp about the fundamental concept of backgammon, I'm not going to go into all of the movement pieces yet, that's for a much later discussion. But the thing that they don't grasp, beginners tend not to grasp immediately, is that although the board is of course square, or rectangular in this case, it is in fact, when you play the game, more of a circle. Now that sounds rather bizarre, having a square board that's a circle. But the point is how the checkers, or the pieces, these, move. And in a game of backgammon, you don't play opposite the other player, as such. You play around the table. Try and think of it as a clock face, with one player trying to move their pieces in this direction, anti-clockwise, and one person trying to move their pieces clockwise. So when you see a game going and people are moving a piece from here to here, they're not actually just crossing the board in this position. What they're doing is actually moving around from here, around to here, down to that point there. And that means that once you understand that and you see people moving pieces in what seemingly at first seems a strange way, it makes a lot more sense. Okay, a couple of words about the board itself. My board, although it may not appear so here, is not curved along here. That's just because I'm using a wide-angle lens here to cover most of the board at a good angle. Boards come, there is no standard colour, or these are what we call the points. There is no standard colour, they don't have to match the actual checkers. In fact, it's better if they don't, for clarity. This one is probably not the best example at the moment for that, because the black on black and red on red can be a little confusing. The doesn't matter about the colours, these can be all the same colour, they can be rainbow colour. The fact that they're different colours is just for distinction. It doesn't actually signify that these are black's places or these are red's places. other things to bear in mind with a board. There are different types and different sizes. This is not a tournament size board, this is only a small, cheap and cheerful board. And that's kind of why I like it really. It's just easy, it's convenient to take around rather than breaking out the big board. Another thing to bear in mind when buying a board is try and go for the felt or soft covered ones. Although the wood ones are more traditional, in some ways more classical, you will find that as you use the dice, a repeated sound of them hitting the board, if it's on wood, can get very annoying very quickly. So definitely go for a soft type of board. You may want to also try and make sure that the points here, these triangular pointy things, are flush with the board. If they start sticking up and peeling off, then you get interruptions with the dice rolls, and when the checkers move around it causes a bit of trouble. Okay, I think that should just about cover part one. Part two, I hope to go over some of the other parts of the pieces of the game, and then onto some basic moves.